tears, but it was about a 2/5 a day habit. I didn't say liquor a day and be as straight as you are right now. You got issues. And one night, this is not you. And at 4 o'clock in the morning, I picked up my bag, left all my friends laid up in there, and I drove home, and I pulled up at our old church, and I walked straight by the pastor in the back door to go to the drum set to play. And he said, "You had a rough night, didn't you?" And I was like, "If you only knew." But I didn't make it to the drum set stop. I stopped at the altar. Because I didn't realize. That wasn't Jesus telling me to stop, so we're going to keep going. And I just sobbed the entire way home. And all it was God, I completely lost myself. I can't function without that. I need help. And you're thinking, yeah, rehab did him good. I've never stepped foot in rehab. Not that I'm against it by any means. It helps a lot of people. But if you look at the statistics, 2 out of 10 make it. And the thing was, I don't want you to look at this as when I say it. Everything I'm saying sounds like I was an addict. But my thing was, is I was making choices every day. And when I got up, I said, "God, I want you to take me and put me back together. I need to know what's wrong. What are some of these emotions I'm holding on to? What are some of these hurts that I'm holding on to? What are some of these things that I need to get out of my head? Because my head never stops. It's like a ticker tape thing." And I just started a personal journey. Now, I'm not going to sit here and say I stood up that day and never touched another drop. Nope. Because after laying for 3 days in my bed, shaking and physically hurting like somebody was stabbing me all over my body, I took a drink. Because I understood what DTs were. And they suck. And then slowly but surely, I began to say, less of that, more him. Less of that, more him. To the point that was an afterthought. Now, don't bother me a bit. If everybody in here, if we go out and y'all all order drinks, I'm cool. I'm not sitting there going, "That looks so refreshing." Nope. Don't bother me like that. And then I've had people say, "Well, you should own the fact that you're an alcoholic. You should tell the world, yes, I'm a recovering alcoholic." I said, "You're crazy. I'm me. I don't need crutches to stand on. I may stumble and fall, but I've got enough people around me that love me really that can be and that's scary, especially when I look at kids this age. Because whatever the social world, whatever the cultural world is telling them, guys, it's not worth it. The road it will lead you down, you will be so far down that road before you can figure it out. And then when you turn around, you feel like even less than a person before you started. There's adults in here that battle with things every day. But you've learned how to hide them. You've learned how to mask them. You've learned how to put on that $25 smile. And on the inside, there's no engine, sweet pea. I can tell the world I'm a Christian all day long, but my actions will speak louder than my words ever will. I can tell you I love you all day long, but if I'm never there for you, actions speak volumes. So if I understand completely what it's like to be under the influence, most of it was harbored around fear, scaring you to death. But nobody said, look, you're going to make mistakes. You're going to goof up. You're going to skin your knees. But God still loves you. He didn't give up on you. Don't give up on him. Every time you fall down and get a boo-boo, he's there to fix it. You just got to let it. You got to own the fact that you made the boo-boo. You can't walk before the throne room and blame the person behind you. God said, I'll fix everything if you just give me what's in you. If you will truly understand what it means to submit under God. See, this happened, and I didn't mean to talk on all this, but I needed to. If you're under the influence of God, it takes me to an Old Testament story of a young man called Daniel. He was one of the best and the brightest. And King Nebuchadnezzar was going to decide to reprogram them, so to speak, their culture. He took the biggest, the brightest, the best, and took them into Babylonian captivity. And he said, I want you to change their language. I want you to change the way they eat, the way they think, everything. We're going to change their names. And he laid out a feast of food that had already been sacrificed before pagan gods. And Daniel said, nope. You can change my name, and I'll accept that. Because I don't identify with what you see me as anyway. I know how he sees me. But that I will take a stand against. Here's where we got to catch on, guys. There's sometimes we just got to turn the TV off. There's sometimes we just need to change the station. There's sometimes we need to close Facebook and open up the book. It's okay. I'm not saying shut your entire life down. I'm just saying be who God created you to be. If you really want to be under God and under his submission, you got to submit. You got to truly humble yourself and say, what you are offering is far more greater and far more important than what culture is offering. And if I want to see my culture change, then I need to be the change agent. I long for a day that in the middle of the protest, in the middle of the chaos, a singular voice could rise up and say, you know what, guys? Listen, there's a better way. And that there's such authority behind that voice, Lord, that everyone stops and listens. A lot like when Peter walked out of the upper room and preached the first real message after Jesus. And 3,000 people came to know him. That's authority. The authority that God had given to a man like Smith Wigglesworth, who barely had an eighth grade education and was illiterate until his wife taught him how to read the Bible, has documented stories of walking onto trains and just walking on the train, Lord, people, all people in every seat would bow to one knee and repent immediately. He didn't even have to open his mouth. That's under God. That's when God walks in a room before you do. You don't have to walk in the room and hope God shows up. So when I say we are one nation under God, we'll get into some next week about what is liberty and justice. Because a lot of people are watching for justice right now and they don't understand what real justice really is. Justice and liberty was bought on a cross 2,000 years ago. Amen. And you can't lose it if you've got it. Now that probably just made a lot of people mad. Well, yes, you can. No, you can't. We seek justice in what we feel is justice. But let's look at what justice, what led up to what we call justice. There's really only one judge, and they're not the Supreme Court. What is justice? What led that person down that road that led to a certain outcome? Could it have been prevented? Every day we wake up, we're not guaranteed to go to sleep. And every night we go to sleep, we're not guaranteed. leverage culture. That's what you're seeing now. To change how we think. To change how the Christian world thinks. He'll have you believe that what you think is important is important. And as long as you got God in your heart, you're going to be okay. Don't believe the lie. Yeah, God's in your heart and you're going to heaven. But you had a chance to affect that entire generation. Where do you fit on that culture scale? Only you can answer that question this morning, guys. I know when I did my personal assessment, I was not happy with it. There's things I need to change. There's things I need to look at closer. There's things that for me to get where I want to go in Christ, I've got to take a direct approach to it. I can't skate around them anymore. There's things in my life that need to be removed. There's people in my life that need to be removed. Don't mean I don't love them. But if every time I'm around you, all you've got is a joke, it's probably not a knock-knock, who's there kind of deal. Might not need to be there. There's comedians. I love comedy. There's comedians I probably shouldn't listen to. Because you know what? What goes in is going to sit here. There's images I see on the TV screen that stay here. Why? Because we're trained to think. Have you ever wondered how you can remember every word to a song that you probably shouldn't know? But if somebody asks you your social security number, you're like, I don't know. Where's these two at? There they are. What's your driver's license number? I don't know. Why would I need that? It's right here on my card. But you can tell me every song with every word under mankind that shouldn't be said. I wanted to crawl under a rock one day because me and my son loved to drive around and listen to music. And he put on something. It was horrible. It was bad. I won't even repeat it. He's like, listen to this, Dad. Yeah, the preacher's kid. Yeah. And so I said, he said, what'd you listen to when you used to ride around? Wasn't Jesus on the main line? So I threw in a song by an artist that I was very fond of. And it started off in about the first 25 seconds, I wanted to crawl under the truck. He looked at me with a smile on his face. Because that was justification. And said, you can't never say anything about what I listen to. And he's right. But I have a choice now to not listen to that. I could still ride around today and bump it. And I even picked at him. I said, it's sad that that song's 22 years old. And I know every word like it just come out yesterday. I don't know every word to every praise song we sing. Y'all laugh, neither does the praise team. But let Marvin Gaye come on. I'm like, mm-hmm. I listened to beach music this week because I got the privilege to go hang out with some good friends at the beach for a couple days. No, I didn't post any pictures of my toes or anything. But I put on beach music, and I love beach music. And I'm like, these songs are from the 50s and 60s, and I can sing every word. And I'm thinking, you know why? Because it was part of my culture. It was what I thought was important, so I hooked on to it. If God becomes a part of you, you hook on to it. And it becomes a part of you that can't live without it. And there comes a part of you that will do whatever it takes to get closer to Him. And it don't take chaos and tragedy. It just takes, it's a normal Monday. For some of y'all, that is tragedy and chaos, but I'm just going to spend some time with God. And that's going to be cool because me and Him's cool like that. And I love Him more than anything, so I want to. What helped you form that opinion? The information you were given. What if somebody gave you added information? Would it change your opinion? Or are you so fixated on your opinion that you refuse to grow? I believe opinions are made to be changed, not by us arguing, but by us having a conversation and educating one another. Now, I'm proud to say, I am ignorant to a lot of things, but I'm willing to learn. And if you'll sit down and have an intelligent conversation, I'll be glad to learn. I'm really not going to learn by you barking at me and telling me how wrong I am and how bad I am. So why do churches do that, Amy? Why do we bark at people and tell them how wrong they are? And hope that that changed their opinion. I'm not trying to change your opinion on God. I'm trying to change your life. And the only person that can change your life, Hunter, is God. So I learned a long time ago, all I need to do is present God like this. Hey, Hunter, I got this cool dude that I roll with. His name's God. He would really like to know you. And she's like, well, where's he at? I'd really like to meet this guy, this Jesus fella. He's as close as you want. What you mean? All you gotta do is talk to him. Well, he's not there. Well, half the people you talk to on social media is not there.
More ways than one.
Seriously. Physically, of course, they're not there. Most of them mentally are not there. They're definitely emotionally not there. How you doing, Keith? Keith is in the,
I'm great.
I don't know how he's doing. I know what he's seeing. But you know who does know how he's doing?
Yes.
The one that's sitting in the room with him. The one that's living on the inside of his heart. The one that's seen every tear he cried collected in a jar according to the word. He knows more about you than you do. So why do we make it so complicated to just introduce Jesus to people? I can't talk about Jesus to my friends. They may look at me wrong. That's called Christianity light, and we don't serve that here. I'm looking for some radical folks that know that God loves them beyond a shadow of a doubt. No matter what you've done, where you've come from, what's been done to you, it's like I'm kicking the crutches out from under your arms today. You either choose to walk, and if you can't walk, crawl. But by all means, don't stop. Because he's waiting for you. He's sitting in the throne room waiting for you to fully understand what it's like to be under God. Bow your head. Dear gracious Heavenly Father, thank you first and foremost for allowing me to lead your people, Lord. There's no greater honor in this life than to be a mouthpiece for you. Father, help everyone chase after you in a way that we're unfamiliar with. I'm tired of being church as usual. Our nation is hurting. Our nation is hungry. Our nation needs a change. Our nation needs you. And Father, I won't stop talking and I won't stop praying till there's an outpouring from heavenly places that we can't contain or control. I'm asking you to flood the streets with your glory. I'm asking you to flood these hearts that's in this room with your anointing and your glory and your compassion and your love. Your grace and mercy has extended upon us, Father.